Hello, I'm Brigadier Peter Moore, or CP Moore. I joined the Army Reserve in 1981 at the age of 17 and became an infantry soldier and was later on commissioned in 1990. I then served a series of regimental appointments in Adelaide in the infantry battalions and the training units. And I've been posted to Sydney, Canberra and now Perth. My previous job was in the 2nd Division as the G5, which is the plans officer. That role entailed working out the structure of the 2nd Division and going through every position, 10,843 of them, and working out the structures of what they needed to be. So from that posting in Sydney, I was posted over here to command the 13th Brigade. As a commander of a reserve brigade, I'm responsible for overseeing the raising, training and the sustaining of the forces. That involves force posture, generating capability, etc. I'm also the senior army officer in Western Australia, which involves a lot of details that are more than outside of the brigade and dealing with force elements, recruiting and other agencies as well. Part of that role sees me as the commander of the JTG, the Joint Task Group for COVID-19. And that's a joint, which is Army, Navy and Air Force capability with all of the assets of Western Australia. So that's been really quite interesting. The role of the JTG is to actually support the state government in their response to COVID. And that's had a wide variety of people where we've had 600 odd people deployed in supporting that. And that's gone from assisting the police with checkpoints, compliance checking, baggage removals, and also, most importantly, and one of the really important tasks that we've done is been involved in assisting the government agencies in their planning and training, and the military and defence backgrounds of the people have been really good with that, because we're generalists, that we talk about a wide variety of things. So we talk about multiple dilemmas in multiple areas, which has been very helpful to the government. 13 Brigade is very interesting in the fact that it was raised in Victoria in 1912, and the first brigade commander was one Colonel John Monash. So in Victoria it was a militia brigade. When the First World War broke out, it was still a militia brigade, and after the withdrawal from Gallipoli, it was activated and brought in as part of the AIF. So it's had some famous roles in the World War I. One of the most important one was Villers-Bretonneux. It played a very important role in winning that back, which was pivotal in the turn of the war. After the First World War, it was disbanded, like most of the units, and in 1921 it was re-raised in Western Australia as part of the 5th Military District as the 13th Brigade. So it went through for a while, and in the interwar periods when it grew and shrunk a fair bit, and then in the Second World War it was used predominantly for a fair bit of coastal defence until about 1943 of the Western Australian coastal defence. In about 1943 it was then sent to New Britain into the Pacific campaign, and it was had a big role in repatriation of Japanese prisoners. 1946 it was disbanded again, and in 1948 it was re-raised again in Western Australia, and it stayed as a militia or a CMF training unit until 1960. Where it was disbanded once again when we introduced the Pentropic Divisions. And it wasn't until 1988 that it was re-raised again and has been in constant existence since then. So it's got a number of the units at the moment, which is one of the famous ones, the 10th Light Horse, which I'm very pleased to say. I got confirmation today we're re-raising another squadron of 10th Light Horse, so there's another 100 people in the 10th Light Horse. We've got the 1128th Battalion and the 16th Battalion. 11th Battalion is famous for the Egypt photo, and the 16th Battalion's got a long, proud history. We've also got the engineers, and again, we've just been given confirmation that another troop, another 30-odd construction engineers have been approved. So we're growing our capability in Western Australia, which is really good. And of course, most importantly, we've got a logistics battalion, 13 CSSB, which enables our logistics support with drivers, medics, cooks, and other logistics capability. Well, we've got people obviously here at Irwin Barracks, but we've got we've also got up at Kalgoorlie, Joondalup up down at Albany, and Rockingham as well. So we've got depots over the all over the place. We tend to move. We've got the capability of moving troops to our tasks, and we force concentrate a lot, and then we will then deploy whether we have to generate the capability. Well, it really goes everything from Kalgoorlie down to Albany, which would be an out across just below Geraldton. With the JTG, it's the whole of Western Australia, so it's all of the resources, including the Pilbara and Kimberley, and the Navy assets at Stirling as well. Currently, we're sitting just over 1,000 people. We've got and the workforce mix. We were talking about a total workforce capability of about 100 full time and just over 900 part time and 25 public servants. So we're looking at growing that. As I said today, we've got expansion of about another 100 for the Cav Scouts, which is the 10th Light Horse, and another 30 odd for engineers. And we're looking to see if we can expand that again. Karakata is about to go a serious redevelopment of about $270 million in the new capability. So we're in the process of planning that at the moment. We're going to bring in some of the other resources that we've got, the University Regiment, which is involved in 8th Brigade, which is a training capability, and some more modern planning facilities. So. Karakata has been around with Hobbs Artillery Base, so it was originally a field firing range, which they fired from the front gate into the ocean, and in the 2,100 years later, it'll be developed into a modern military base with the influx of new facilities and new buildings. 2022-23, the first sods will be turned. We've actually got some of the detailed planning going on at the moment. It takes a while for some of this stuff to come to fruition. The second division is predominantly a part-time division, and its role is to support defence operation, raise, train, sustain in order to support surging. On operations recently, 10% of the people deployed on operation are part-time or reservists, and currently over the last few years we've supported regional stability operations in Ramsey, in the Solomon Islands, transit security elements of border protection, and we do a number of rotations for that. We provide troops for the rifle company Butterworth, which is a strategic footprint in Southeast Asia and Malaysia, which is very important to the Australian government there. And we also have supported activities, individuals and round out and reinforcement in Afghanistan and Iraq in the last 3 or 4 years. So that's our current roles at the moment. But we're now transitioning to a role where we will be responsible for domestic support operations, bar counter-terrorism, because special people do that. But so some interesting things are happening right as we speak with our roles and tasks. And we're getting, and as a result of that, we'll be equipped with different types of equipment and more capability in Western Australia to fulfil some of those roles. Well, at the middle of March, we sort of came in here and we were planning to do some activities of domestic incident response, and then we got a phone call that our focus was on COVID, and we went into plan with the state government. Our role is to support the state government and other agencies in their response to do this. We force prepared 711 people, so ready to go, and they were ready at very short notice, and that's including a significant Navy contingent as well. We've deployed about 600 people on that over the period of the last 12 weeks, and their roles have gone from supporting police checkpoints in the regional areas and also around Perth and the Peel region, and also planning, very important role, planning, assisting people in intelligence gathering, and also compliance checking as well with the police. So we've got a number of liaison officers, which are in a number of agencies, which help communicate between the agencies and also give us situational awareness. Well, this year we had assisted with bushfire assist. So we sent about 113 people over to Kangaroo Island. With that, we also sent them to the goldfields, where our signals capability enhanced the DFES fire tracking. So that was really, really quite an effective employment, and they deployed by train, which was really quite interesting. We've also supported fires down at Albany and other the regions. So we've got a standing task of an emergency support force, so to respond at short notice to humanitarian assistance or disaster relief capabilities. So this year we've had a fair few people doing a fair few things. Well, and depending on the task, you know, obviously if it's an engineering task, we'll need engineering equipment. If it's communications, we need communications. We've got, as we say, we've got a lot of generalists that we can provide work party communications, logistics support, food, stretchers, tents, if necessary, medics. There are a number of different trades, and obviously we employ the right people for the task at the time. There's Mouchet as well, and Lancelin. Bindoon's, there's some range work going on at the moment. We're developing that, and they're upgrading the Scale A area of that. So there's a constant investment in Western Australia and the facilities that we're seeing over the last couple of years, and certainly for the next few that we expect to see some significant investment in these areas, so they'll improve them. But we use them for field training, ranges, and obviously where with the domestic incident security, we can pretty much train anywhere because we don't necessarily have to be in the field or in a bush environment for all of that sort of training. We use all the facilities as required, because not all the training is the same, so each facility will suit certain parts of training. We've got an effective weapons simulation training centre in here, which is really good. It's high tech, that can actually do mortars as well, so to support the artillery units in Western Australia. So we've done a lot of, the second division's done a fair bit of reorganisation in the last few years, and some of the elements of 13 Brigade have moved into a specialist area for technical control. But when it comes to an operation, we then force assign people for task based on skill sets. The training exercise, we hold a various series of different training depending on the tasks. Last year that we did some training in Townsville, supporting the 3rd Brigade. We sent a combat team, which is about 120 people all up, including our lift capability, and they were very, very well prepared there. We do exercises for domestic incident response, and we're tested on that annually, and we're going to spend a little bit more time on doing that. We work with agencies such as the police and the emergency services to respond to those sort of exercises. We do field training, we do training courses so that their skills, their trade and rank capability is adequately adopted. We've got a PHILO, which is a Formation Indigenous Liaison Officer. We go through Defence Force recruiting and we actively promote that. The Pilbara Regiment and the Kimberley have done a significant amount of work, and the Pilbara have increased dramatically the Indigenous participation in that. We've got a very proud tradition in Western Australia. We're dealing with Aboriginal issues in defence, and we've got about 1.5% of our brigade that identify as being Aboriginal, whereas Pilbara and Kimberley have a lot more. And it's a very important thing. The Western Australian University Regiment had a wonderful presentation of the colours, which incorporated significant Aboriginal influence of the Western Australian flavour into that, and that was really, really pleasing to see. I think it's a very exciting time. We've been given extra capability. Defence wants to enhance the capability in Western Australia, and including 13 Brigade. We've got growth in the CAV Scout capability. We've got growth in our engineering capability, which gives us the ability to support humanitarian assistance, disaster relief. And we're looking to recruit and grow the size of the brigade. So I think it's got a very bright future, and I'm looking forward to see it. And of course, with the base redevelopment, a significant investment in our facilities and outputs.